officer in the U.S. Marine Corps. He did his flight training in Pensacola, Florida, and has did 500 combat missions in Vietnam. He attended the Fighter Weapons School at Miramar, California, also known as Top Gun. He graduated from the Naval Test Pilot School at Patuxent River?
Got it.
Okay. Maryland. He's got 6,500 hours of flight time under his belt and has done over 100 carrier landings. He was selected, that's the hard word today, selected, guys, by NASA in 1980 and flew on two shuttle missions, STS-29 and STS-38. So here for you today, we have astronaut Bob Springer.
Well, thank you. So after reading an article in this morning's paper, my first question for you is, has anybody in here applied for the astronaut program? Did I? Very good. And the only reason I asked that question, I'm absolutely astounded. The year I applied, we had about 10,000 people that applied for the program. This class, that they just finished the initial request for selections, and 18,300 people applied for the program this year, so which is more than double the last couple of years that they've selected. So it's going to be an interesting competition. In fact, I had a young woman that I had met at like one of these classes, and she decided to apply for the program, so she had asked me to review her resume and things like that. She's got a very, very strong resume, and I said, you know, and I was just thinking about normal selection. I said, you probably stand at least a good chance of getting into the interview portion of the selection process. And I may have to go back. Well, it's going to be a tough selection process if you got 18,000 people that have applied for the program. Quick note on that, just in case anybody's interested in applying. The requirements have actually changed a little bit over time. When I applied, the announcement read something like you have to have a minimum of a bachelor of science degree in a technical field, science, technology, engineering, or math. And as I like to tell people, there's nothing against art, music, literature, but this is rocket science, and having a technical background is important. As a pilot, minimum 1,000 hours of single pilot and jet time, and be a graduate of a military test pilot school. So the pilots basically all come from the military. Even folks like Neil Armstrong, who was a civilian, he'd been a former Navy pilot. And so that was one of the criteria. The things that they've changed now, still have to have a minimum of a bachelor of science degree in there, including in there, and graduate education is preferred. And pretty much if you don't have a graduate degree, don't bother applying. You're probably, unless you've just got an incredible history of experience, and instead of being a graduate of a military test pilot school now, just as you must have, as a pilot, you must have a minimum of 1,000 hours of the single pilot of jet time. But they've changed that now, and I think opening up the field a little bit from the standpoint of saying you must have 3 years of proven performance with ever-increasing areas of responsibility. So they're looking for people who are out there go-getters and looking for increased responsibility and working in that kind of an environment. But less and not surprising when you look at the missions that are ahead of us out there, hopefully going to Mars in the not-too-distant future. Not too distant in this case means 20 years or so, but looking for people with a more of a broad spectrum background. I know in my case that's probably one of the things that I kind of had going for me. I'm both a jet pilot and a helicopter pilot. I have combat experience in both, and test pilot experience in both, and a couple of graduate degrees. So that kind of broad-based background and worked in a variety of different fields probably helped me during the application process. So, just in case anybody's interested, unfortunately the window is already closed this year for applications. So you'll probably have to wait another 2 to 3 years before they open it up. But it's a lot easier. Just go online, www.jobs.gov/astronaut. I'm serious. That's really it. So this is a fun time. Hopefully for you, it certainly is for me. I really encourage you, because the best part of this is the opportunity to ask the questions that you've always wanted to ask. So please don't hesitate. This is not a lecture. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my experience and how it relates to some of the things you're going to get to see and do today. But there are times when I spend the whole time just answering questions, and I usually can find a PowerPoint slide that that illustrates a good bit of the kinds of things you're interested in. So please don't hesitate at all. Just raise your hand, and I'll be more than happy to stop. Let's see. I'm not trying to embarrass anybody, but I know I talk fast. Is everybody fluent in English or some version of English? Everybody okay with that? If I'm going too fast, I can ratchet it down a couple of notches, but I'm pretty enthusiastic about the program, and so a lot of things to share and talk about and tell you about. So any questions to start off with? Just anything that's on anybody's mind? Go ahead, sir.
Was it harder to land a responsive jet on a moving carrier or to land the shuttle orbiter on a fixed runway?
Let me give you the worst example of that from the standpoint of the carrier landing. And it's a little bit of why I went into carrier aviation in the first place. When I went to the Naval Academy, each summer, we don't really call it a college, it's a little bit different. So, but each summer you get to do what they call an experience tour. So my first summer that after finishing the academic year, spent 3 months on board a Navy destroyer, about a 400-foot vessel in primarily in the North Atlantic. And we did what we call underway replenishment. And it's where you take on fuel and some consumables, all that. It's quite a tricky thing. So you in this case, there was one. Our ship was our destroyer was on one side of the refueling vessel, which was a bigger vessel. Now on the other side of the refueling vessel was an aircraft carrier. Well, it was kind of North Atlantic, not bad storm, but moderate storm. And our destroyer was going like this, and I looked over at the tanker, and it was going like this, and I looked over at the carrier, and it was going like that. I said, "That's the one I want to be on." There are times when you get some very, very bad storms. You get what's called the pitching deck, and believe it or not, you know that huge aircraft carrier, the deck will actually rise and fall some 20 to 30 feet. And at nighttime, with the rain coming down, there's not a tougher assignment in the world. It's much, much harder, I think, than the difficulty with the shuttle is that you're coming in unpowered. And we'll talk more about that. But it's an interestingly different approach. We have had, just to go back to the carrier side of it, over the years we have come up with a fully linked system. And when you first do this, you're going, I'm not sure. But what you do is you link up with the automated system on board the ship, and you go hands off carrier landing. I mean, just absolutely nothing. Don't touch the stick. Don't touch the throttle. Just put the gear and the tail hook down, and the electronics take over. I'll tell you what. When you're not used to that the first time, you don't fold your arms and do it. You got your hand on the throttles and your hand right behind the stick because you know something's going to go wrong. We did actually have an automated system, a autopilot, if you will, for landing the shuttle. We never fully trusted it. And you'll understand that when we talk a little bit about the computer side of the shuttle. The other thing is you're coming in with the shuttle, you've got about a 225,000-pound craft that's landing unpowered. And very, very susceptible to last-minute gusts of wind. And believe it or not, an experienced pilot actually can beat a computer at making adjustments in that kind of a scenario. So we always land. We're all into the Atlantic. So let me tell you a little bit about it. I'm sure you've probably all, any pilots in the group, by the way? Any aviators, pilots?
Long time ago in single engine.
It all counts. It's all part of it. It's one of the things I learned from test pilot school. The really fascinating part of test pilot school is flying. I've probably flown about 40 different type of aircraft, helicopters, jets, props, and each airplane, each aircraft has unique characteristics to it, and finding out what those unique characteristics are fun. So, yeah, there's an interesting side of going Mach 2, but there's an interesting side of hovering in a helicopter too. So, when you're coming in, normal commercial airliner, you're coming in fairly gentle, about a 3-degree glide slope. You're descending at about 1,500 feet per minute rate of descent, and landing in about 145 miles per hour. With your engines running. When you're coming back from space, that final aspect of it, basically when you deorbit, you fall out of space until you hit the atmosphere, and then you slow down, use the friction of the air molecules to slow the vehicle down. But when you're coming in on that final descent, you actually, instead of a 3-degree glide slope, it's a 21-degree glide slope. instead of 1,500 feet per minute rate of descent, it's 15,000 feet per minute rate of descent, and you're landing a 225,000 pound glider at about 200 miles per hour. So it is a bit more challenging and a little less forgiving, because the one thing you can't, there's no such thing as a touch and go in the shuttle program. So you have to really stay ahead of the airplane, and that's primarily why they want jet pilots in that pipeline. Actually, the helicopter, if you're just a pure helicopter pilot, that wouldn't qualify you for the shuttle pilot program. Yes, sir?
What are some things that you hope we learn by putting a person on Mars?
Let me go back philosophical a bit. For one thing, I really think from a philosophical standpoint, we as a species, as a race, when we stop having that inquisitive nature that says, we're going to cross the oceans, we're going to cross the continent, we're going to see what's on the other side of the mountains, the other side of the ocean. When we lose that spark of initiative, I think we cease to exist as a race. So I think there's a philosophical aspect to it. The benefit side, you gotta think long term on these kinds of things. Would we ever likely populate Mars? Let's just say something catastrophic event happened inside our solar system. And, again, you're thousands of years downstream. So if something happened that would affect Earth, it would probably affect Mars as well. But Mars is a stepping stone in learning how to make that transition if mankind ever does need to leave our home planet. Where do you go? How do you get there? And some of the work that NASA is doing these days long term with things like the Hubble Space Telescope and all that, looking into solar systems that are light years away and all that, billions of light years away. So can we get there today? No, but it's going to be a stepping stone approach, and I think someday we'll figure that out. So the real value is not necessarily the destination, it's the journey and what we can learn while we're there. There may be materials we talk about of the lunar surface as well. There may be things that we can mine from asteroids on the lunar surface and things like that. Maybe not. We won't know until we give it a try. But I think from my standpoint, the philosophical thing, and part of it, is I do a lot of lectures to students. I'm very, very involved in the educational process, trying to get our young people more interested in science, technology, engineering, and math. And having those kinds of goals and the kinds of challenges that you have to meet to be able to do that are absolutely key to keeping people and our young people involved.
I really like hearing.
Well, thank you. Yes, sir.
There's been a big shift from mechanical engineering and electrical engineering to computer science as a way to inject complexity. Is NASA following that shift? Everything I saw before is you're trying to harden everything as much as possible. So it wasn't as much of a misheading computer science on it.
Yeah. NASA is a general statement is slow to jump on those kinds of bandwagons and it has to do as much with cost and funding and what you can do in terms of that. And so a lot of times, in fact, if you follow this year's federal budget, there's a big swing in NASA's budget. For the first time in, I don't know, three or four decades, the aerospace, the aeronautics side of NASA is getting increased funding. Unfortunately, they did that by taking it away from the space side, but the aeronautics thing. So we're looking at going back to some kind of supersonic transport, or there's some interesting configurations out there. But NASA in general has not been the real leader in that kind of technology advancement. And it's just, again, as much as anything else, the funding limitations. You can only support so many initiatives. And from that standpoint, having NASA develop the space shuttle was probably a mistake because it got bogged down in the operations side of it as well. And so, and we'll touch for just a moment on what's coming in the future, SpaceX and the Blue Origin and the different programs that are out there. And I think that's going to actually help NASA in the long run so that NASA can go back and look more at the innovative type things as opposed to the operating side of things, which probably shouldn't have happened anymore. Yes, ma'am?
So talking about the application process, Was that always your plan to be an astronaut, or was that what made you decide?
No, absolutely great. Thanks you for asking, because I'm the, although I'm not the only one, but in fact I noticed in the last class that was selected, there's a real nice article about the four women that were selected, and I don't remember which one, but one of the four sort of mirrored my application. Never thought about it. Went through military career. In fact, I had when NASA opened up the application, I knew that. In fact, I was a test pilot at the time. And then I was thinking about it and had a friend that I'd gone to graduate school with, an Army officer, and he came over to my house one Saturday morning and said, are you going to apply for the astronaut program? I said, I really hadn't given it that much thought. And he handed me the application, printed application back then, and he said, fill it out and send it in. I didn't got selected. So, but that's my whole career pattern, by the way, is my wife is so frustrated because it comes down to this, the question of bucket list, and she always says, so what's on your bucket list? And I'm like, no. And it's not because I've been there, done that. My whole philosophy on life is like, well, something exciting is going to happen. I'll just be ready for it when it comes. And it turns out that's the way it worked. And it turns out the woman that had very, very much the same story, military aviator, and I don't know whether it was the first time. I was very fortunate to apply once and got selected. That's kind of unusual. A lot of people these days apply 2, 3, 4 times before they get selected. But I just as it turns out, I did. I had all the requisite background. And by the way, to kind of cap off the selection process is kind of unique. You go through they winnow down. In my class, we had about 10,000 people that applied. They winnowed it down to 200 people that came down for interviews. It's a week long. Mental, physical, and psychological process, capped off by an interview that really is the keynote to it, and it's kind of unique. It was the most interesting job interview I've ever done in my life. I've done more than one. They bring you into a room. They've got a kind of a semicircle table with about 10-12 people. At the time that I applied, George Abbey, who was the legendary head of the astronaut office. John Young, one of our more senior astronauts. So some senior astronauts, and then somebody from HR. Typical interview process, and they put you under in a chair, kind of under a light like it. It feels more like an Inquisition, but it's always interesting. So they make sure they identify yourselves as well. All right, Colonel Springer, starting with high school, tell us about yourself. What are you? That's the question, and you get to spend as much or as little time, Fortunately, I had kind of anticipated something like that. I mean, they would, I hadn't actually put it together that well. There was all kinds of rumors they were going to ask you questions about current events. But they do ask you occasionally then, and the questions they ask you are designed to get you off balance. That's the only reason they're asking the questions. I mean, I'll illustrate it. One of the questions, in fact, John Young asked this question. So I was in the middle of something, and he says, Colonel Springer, he says, I know that you recently were at Patuxent River. What can you tell this group about the gun gas burning problem on the F-14 aircraft? Well, now there's an esoteric topic for you. As it turns out, the F-14 has an internal gun, and as the gun fired, the unburnt products of combustion of the explosion and fire in the cartridge were actually being re-ingested and catching fire underneath the belly of the airplane. What Captain Young didn't know is, as I was head of weapons systems test, that was one of my you just got to be ready for whatever life throws at you. And so I started into this really detailed engineering explanation. They didn't want to hear any of that. I mean, shucks, we didn't catch them off. And the question is, are we going to catch you off guard? The other one that was kind of interesting, if there is a right or wrong answer, I think I got it right. We'll ask you, if you don't get selected, what are you going to do? I had a very, very talented classmate who got that, and he said, oh, I don't know. He was one of the guys, ever since he'd been 3 years old, he wanted to be an astronaut. He says, if I don't get selected, I don't know what I'm going to do. Probably not the best answer. And my answer is, well, you know, I really want to be selected, but I've got a great career going in the Marine Corps. I'll go back and finish up. Probably a little better answer than that. The only other thing is, and you realize the week that you're there, everybody you talk to is interviewing you, and On Thursday night, they always have a bit of a dinner. They'll again bring in some of the astronauts that are currently. And when I was there, about the same size group, they're about 40 or so experienced. Mostly some of the guys who had been selected for Apollo but didn't fly, including a very good friend of mine, Jack Lauswell, who's also a Marine Corps colonel. So we got in, and they give you a few adult beverages, and I think they do that deliberately. They want to loosen you up, and they want to see, you know, what kind of personality you have and all that. And in George Abbey, again, and if there is one official in the whole process that, you know, if he gave you a thumbs up, it was a thumbs up. If he gave you a thumbs down, it was a thumbs down. So, and George always orchestrated these dinners. And so we got ready, had a couple of adult beverages, and we're sitting down to dinner. And as we sat down, Abby, in a very, very droll voice, said, well, before we get started, one of your classmates has something he'd like to say to you, Colonel Springer. And I'm sitting there like, what? I have no idea what he's talking about. So I slowly get up, and as I'm getting up from my chair, I realize it's November 10th, it's the Marine Corps birthday, and I'm in the Marine Corps. So I stood up and said, well, thank you very much, Mr. Abbey. Thank you, everybody, for being here to help me celebrate the 204th anniversary of the founding of our beloved Corps. On occasions like this, it's always a custom to introduce the youngest Marine. I believe I hold that distinction. And then to introduce the oldest Marine. So next to me is Colonel Jack Lauser. At that point in time, I said, so at this point in time, I'd like to introduce the oldest Marine, Colonel Jack Lauser. I looked at Abby's face, and I'll tell you what, if there was any part, I think I was in at that point. I really do. That was, you know, just serendipity. Just things sometimes work out as they're supposed to. Anything else? Super. We guys are doing good. This is great. A lot more fun for me on this. So two flights in the program for me selected. Actually, in the class the selection took place in 1979. Came on board in 1980. You go through at that time what they call the AsCan, Astronaut Candidate program. It's an evaluation process. Nobody's ever dropped out or been dropped during that evaluation, but it's a chance. I think really as much as anything else for you to also evaluate the job. You know, do you want to be there? It's unique. It's as you can well imagine, a lot of work that goes into a lot of long hours, a lot of family separation and things like that. So they ask a lot of you, and you do get a chance to back out. Originally selected, I would have been the first one in my class to fly in 1983 on a joint ESA-NASA mission, European Space Agency. That flight was lost funding, was canceled. Went back in the queue for a flight that kept sliding, eventually slid into March of 1986. Of course, we had the Challenger accident in January of that year. Whole program shut down for 30 months while we reconstituted. My crew stayed together. It was kind of good news. I probably better trained than the average person that was going through the problem. The only negative part about that is our first task was to go back and refly the Challenger profile. And that got to be hard. Because you go through and we're trying to figure out what could the crew have known, what could they have anticipated. It turns out it wouldn't have made any difference. They were doomed virtually at liftoff. The end product of all that is finally flew my first flight in March 1989, so a long time in the queue getting ready for that. Five-person crew up there. Of course, we did, with the shuttle program, unique, we started selecting women in the program for the first time. I personally would have liked to have had the diversity of having one or more women on the crew. I think it would have lent a little bit more to it in some ways, but neither of my crews did. Five of us on that first flight. Turns out the four to the right, and I really did have more hair at that time. The one guy who's ahead of us in terms of disappearing hair follicles, Jim Bajan, a medical doctor. And it was kind of nice to know, and you know, although we rarely had any real problems on board flights, nice to know that you've got a doc on board to help you if you do. But, turned around about a year later, flew on my second flight. Kind of unique again, one of six Department of Defense classified missions. Lost in the history of the program is that from the get-go, and actually even in some of the design criteria, it's not a mistake that payload bay was 60 feet long and 15 feet in diameter. That was sized uniquely to handle some classified DOD payloads. after the Challenger accident, DOD started to pull back away from it. They decided they didn't want to risk their payloads on something as fragile. Crew's okay, payloads not so much. But we had a few payloads manifested. Mine was one of those, kind of unique. Actually launched in November of 1990. Five military pilots on that group. One from each of the service academies. By the way, we had Sam Gamer was West Point, Frank Culbertson and myself were both Naval Academy graduates. Dick Covey was an Air Force Academy graduate. Kind of had a lot of fun on that flight. Still can't talk about it. Still classified. 25 years later, still relevant technology. It always pains me to have to tell you because it was so neat. But I still can't tell you about it. So kind of a unique flight. You're going to get a chance to get inside our trainer cockpit out here. Not quite as complex as what you see here. This is actually the upgraded version of the cockpit, the one that I flew in, what was on the drawing boards. You got to remember, Shuttle was actually on the drawing boards the early 1970s. Conceptually, it was there from the 1960s, but started to pull that together in the 1970s. So the original Shuttle cockpit, and you can still see some vestiges of it in here, 1970s aerospace technology. My vehicles had three computer screens inside and a lot more what we call hardwired switches and gauges. We took out a lot of those hardwired switches and gauges, put in a total now of nine multifunction displays or computer screens. Put the computer stuff in perspective. Does anybody, I'm going to look around for gray hair here, anybody remember what a Commodore 64 was? All right, you guys have been right at home. That was pretty much what we had in terms of memory and processing speed and all that. So we did upgrade that in the 1990s. Of course, a spacecraft that will fly in the future, much more advanced and more of the open architecture. One of our real limitations in changing anything, this was anything but open architecture. I mean, when you made a change, snowball through the entire vehicle. So lots and lots of challenges inside there. But a big advantage when we did upgrade the computers and add a total of nine multifunction displays, not the least of which, and something I experienced on one of my flights and would have loved to have had it, we had a malfunction that required me to reach up and throw an overhead switch. Remember, when you lift off, about 3 G's acceleration, so that's just a multiplier of 3 of your own body weight, plus the 100 pounds of gear that you're wearing, the suit and the gear that you're wearing. So about 300 pounds extra weight, of course, accelerate as you accelerate at 3 Gs. Good news is your arms are quite strong enough to be able to reach up. And in fact, one of the first things you do on your first flight, we do what we call an arm sweep, just to prove it to yourself that you can do it. Yes, I can reach around and touch all the switches you need to touch from whatever seat that you happen to be in. But in this case, I had an overhead switch throw that I had to make, and you don't want to throw the wrong switch during these occasions. And I was pretty sure I knew where the switch was, but I wanted to see, well, you've got a fairly bulky helmet on, and you can't really tilt your head back. And so in order to be able to see the switch, I actually had to take my head off the headrest and crank my neck back like that. I could see the switch through the switch. The only trouble is that helmet normally weighs about 12 pounds, 3 Gs. 36 pounds equivalent. Your neck isn't actually that strong. Don't try it, but you know, try and think of putting an almost 40 pound weight and doing neck exercise. If you're a wrestler, maybe you can do that, but in general not. And my head got stuck there, which is what it boiled down to. And so to avoid getting to orbit with a big crick in my neck, I actually put my hands behind my head, actually had to pick my head back up and put it back on the headrest. So, with the upgraded cockpit, fewer and fewer of those types of switches. So it's a lot easier to reach down to the keyboard there at your left or right knee, type in an address, a command, and hit execute than it is to have to reach around. An incredible complexity in there, and that was the real trick to it. As you go through, you've seen we had backups for critical components, three levels of backup. We could fail once, fail twice, still fly on that third backup system. But again, with the limitations of the computer, primarily the responsibility of the crew to be able to delve into it and by combining several different indications in the cockpit, figuring out that you've got an electrical bus failure or something like that. You may actually get something that looked like a short circuit on your ECLS system, your environmental life support control system. But you had to start checking other, because there were, if you started to see three or four different instruments that were all off, you realized it probably wasn't one of those. It had a a common route back there, and probably in the electrical system. So hundreds and hundreds of hours going through that. And something that, again, you'll get to see whether you're in the cockpit or inside mission control, tremendous team effort, a lot of teamwork. And so when you're going through your training today, help each other, because that's what we did in the cockpit as well. You know, no one person knows everything. And so help each other identify switches and make the right switches and all that. Lots and lots of training to get to that point in time. I got to do one of the more fascinating parts of it. I was actually selected as a pilot. Never did actually fly as a pilot. I flew as a flight engineer. My reimbursement for that, if you will, was getting to do the EVA stuff, and it was a good trade. I don't know whether you realize it or not, but you know, we talk about flying the shuttle, and you on a nominal mission, you actually only spend about 10-12 minutes flying the shuttle. The rest of it's all putting in an input to the digital autopilot. And so I can literally say I've flown the shuttle. We did a maneuver, and I A, B, C, D, and push the button, go, and the computer does its thing, and the shuttle maneuvers. So the only time we actually fly the shuttle is during that landing. So not too much to give up for it. Spacewalking stuff, very, very fascinating. Probably the most difficult aspect, physically difficult aspect of the training. The reason why, that suit that you see me getting into there weighs about 300 pounds. How many have seen the movie Gravity? You will notice that, unlike Miss Bullock, you actually do wear more in way of undergarments in there. And that's actually your heating and cooling setup. There's if you can look at that, what looks like long underwear on there actually has capillary tubes sewn into it. You circulate either hot or cold water, and you can do that. Why? Temperatures on orbit, plus 300 to minus 300 degrees Fahrenheit. So big switches of temperatures inside there. So very, very complex suit. We spend a lot of time training for that in what we call our neutral buoyancy laboratory. Yes, sir?
So were you constantly hot or cold until the suit was regulated?
You had to manually change the temperature.
Painful and annoying?
No. And for the most part, once you started doing things, you heated up the air in a closed volume like that. So most of the time, you're actually cooling things down. And then on the dark side, it might get a little chilly. But generally speaking, you kind of found a nice range of temperature and just set it and let it go. It was kind of interesting because that previous slide, that the controller is actually here on the front of your equipment, and you can't see it. And so you've got a mirror on your wrist, and you'd have to look at the mirror to be able to adjust the temperature. So little things that could have been handled a little bit better, perhaps.
I have another question about the suit. What else can you control besides the
temperature? Communication.
Is most of it automatic, or do you?
The air revitalization, all that, that's all automatic. You did have some things that you could change. One of some of the other things that you might not think about in there, because we can do up to 8 hours, and so you've got to hydrate. So you use kind of like a camelback type system. You've got a little tube over there. There's only two people that I know of, both women, that can do a little trick. Most of us that are fairly broad shoulders, once you get inside that suit, you can't pull your arm back in. But I know Wendy Lawrence, for one, inside the Russian suit could do that. She's a relatively diminutive person and with kind of narrow shoulders, and she can actually snake her arm all the way back and reach inside. But for the rest of us, you've got a little tube over the side that you reach over and suck water out. We actually have food sticks that we have, and it makes a mess. You'd just soon not deal with the food sticks. And in 8 hours, though, you do need to hydrate. So that is really critical to it. Yes, sir?
Are the American suits still offline?
Was that part of the water problem? No, they haven't really ever fully identified the water issue. And of course there's one of the Italian astronauts that darn near drowned. And of course we got him back inside the airlock and was able to get him out of the suit. We have had some additional events like that, and sort of I don't know why they can't figure out where that water is coming from. That's sort of a surprise. A lot of work going into a new suit. Give you more, something with a little bit more dexterity and all that.
That brings up an interesting, if you do have a problem out there, how long does it take you to actually get back inside?
Well, number one, you're motivated. So, not that long. You can zip back in there. It would be more difficult on the station. Let's say you were way out on one of the trusses or something. It could take you maybe 10, 12 minutes, something like that, to get. But you can hustle along pretty well. Most of the spacewalks you do, you remain hard tethered to the vehicle. If nothing else, you can just follow your tether on just hand over hand on the tether and get back in. So you can get back in even from the most distant reaches 10, 15 minutes or so. In the shuttle payload bay, just a couple of minutes to get back inside. Trick is getting the airlock closed, getting yourself hooked up to the ship system and getting off of the suit and repressurizing the airlock. So you can get out of the suit and breathe. Anything else? So a lot of time inside there. We train like we're going to fly. And again, 300 pounds, and we use the neutral buoyancy laboratory. Unfortunately, we don't have a neutral buoyancy laboratory here. We have our zero gravity wall. Try it. It'll give you a bit of a simulation, you know, where you use counterbalancing weights to basically make you feel a little bit like you're weightless. If you get a chance to do one of the vertical jump trainers, where you can kind of ride the column of air. That's a hoot if you get to. We didn't use that for training, but it's something that you can do out there. It's kind of give you a feeling of what it's like to get along in a weightless environment. Very, very critical though, and a lot of effort that went into doing that. I already talked a little bit about the training. You may have wondered how we do that. Well, a lot of computer simulations. You'll get a chance to practice that. We have a pretty much the same computer simulation for landing that NASA uses, and it's a contest. Those who do the best end up being the pilot and commander for the missions that you'll do. It is challenging. I'll give you one hint in that it's despite the fact you're flying a very, very big aircraft, it's very sensitive to controls. And if you're doing big control movements, you'll be all over the sky and lose control. So it's like driving a sports car. Little input, see what you get, and then kind of hold it in place. So, and again, you'll have fun with that. In addition to the computer sims, we use something called the shuttle training aircraft. It's a modified Gulfstream II. We actually modify it so that it can take the air loads. We modify the cockpit so it has the same control system as the shuttle does. Get suited up just the way you would be for landing. And again, trying to make the environment as realistic as you can. How do we make that Gulfstream II fly, that incredible dynamic approach? Well, we take it up to 30,000 feet. Round numbers, that's generally where we start to take over and fly the shuttle manually. Above that, you're still fairly much falling, and the autopilot does an adequate job there. But from 30,000 feet on, for one thing, that gives you a couple minutes to refamiliarize yourself with just the feel of the craft, do a couple of gentle turns and things like that to get used to it. How do we make it fly the way we do? You can see we drop the main landing gear, and for those that are really observant, you'll notice the nose landing gear is still up. Why is that? The nose gear couldn't take the air loads because we're going to put both engines in full reverse thrust. That will increase the drag on the vehicle enough that gives you that same 15,000 feet per minute rate of descent, 21 degree glide slope. So a lot of training. Every commander who's ever landed the vehicle, 1,000 approaches in a shuttle training aircraft in order to certify. So again, one shot deals, no touch and goes, and so being able to visualize what's happening, and again from the pilot's eye standpoint. I think anybody who's flown the dynamic approaches to a carrier or something like that. I also was on the other end of it, had a tour as a landing signal officer on board a carrier, the guy that stands out there. If you've ever seen any of the World War II movies, he's the guy with the paddles. And to train for that position, you do pretty much the same thing. You spend lots and lots of hours out there watching thousands and thousands of landings. And the way that I try to tell people about it, it's like you're watching a pixel map, and let's just say you've got would be an underestimated number, but say you had 1,000 pixels in your picture. And after you watch that hundreds and hundreds of times, you pretty much know when one pixel is out of place. And that's what gives you, again, from the pilot's viewpoint of the orbiter, that's kind of what you're seeing, because you've seen that picture correctly hundreds and hundreds of times, and when something's a little bit off, you can see it very, very quickly. And again, that's where the human
I can tell things. So lots of practice in that. You guys will enjoy that computer. Bomb and Comet, using a KC-135 going out and flying parabolic arcs. Good practice because, from the laws of physics, when you do those parabolic arcs, as you go over the top of that arc, as much as 90 seconds of true weightless conditions. And from the laws of physics standpoint, you're just as weightless there as you will be in orbit. The only difference is you can't sustain it. So after about 90 seconds, you've got to dive back down, pick your speed up, do a 2G pull-up, and then go up. On training missions, we do about 2 hours worth of those parabolas, 90 to 100 parabolas, hence the name Vomit Comet. Interesting enough, it's not the zero gravity that tends to make people sick, it's the 2G pull-up at the bottom, doing 100 of those during a 2.5 hour. There's a civilian company that actually gives rides on that, the Zero Gravity Corporation, and I used to consult with them, and we get a group in like this, and I'd recommend everybody take an anti-motion sickness drug. And you'd have people that would look at me and I'd say, no, I want to experience everything. I'm like, no, you don't. Because on top of everything else, getting physically sick during that zero gravity portion, it's bad enough if you're seasick aboard a boat, but you can perhaps get to the rail and puke over the side. If you end up getting physically ill over the top of that parabola, it is the biggest mess that you can imagine. Yeah, don't go there. It's take the motion sickness. Quick look at the vehicle itself. You can either see the model up there. Three important parts of the orbiter vehicle itself, the external tank, the solid rocket boosters. External tank, the only part we didn't recover. We jettisoned that once we get to low Earth orbit. It burns up as it re-enters the atmosphere. So a new tank, and probably the least sophisticated part of it. Solid rocket boosters only burn for 2 minutes and 10 seconds. Provides most of the thrust, though, that gets you out of the Earth's atmosphere. 2 minutes and 10 seconds. At that point in time, you're 1/12 of your way to orbit. You've used 85% of your fuel to get there, just to give you an idea. Jettison those off. One of the few surprises I had, because when we did the simulators, my second flight was a night launch, and they didn't model this correctly. We actually used an explosive charge to jettison the solid rocket boosters away. During the daylight, you don't see that explosive charge. At nighttime, it's like, holy crap, what was that? You know, and you realize it was just the solid rocket boosters going. We're going to use that same solid rocket booster technology on our next generation spacecraft shuttle. We recovered the boosters, too dangerous and not that cost effective, so in the future we'll just let them fall in the ocean and we'll go through all that trouble. And then the orbiter vehicle itself, quite an engineering feat to see that massive empty, just under 200,000 pounds lifted into place and mated with the tank. Put all that stuff together on top of the mobile launch platform. Going out the pads. 39B has been deactivated. A is still there. That's what SpaceX will be using. It looks pretty much they're still going to end up disassembling parts of it when SpaceX gets around to launching their manned missions. But they're going to use that pad. NASA has leased it to it. You can see, by the way, something. What's that thing on the top? That's a lightning mast. Central Brevard County is the lightning center of research for the United States. More lightning strikes here than any other place in the U.S. on an annual basis. And so, bad place for a spaceport, by the way, from that standpoint. But we do protect against that. So when you look out the pads, there'll be some kind of lightning protection. Now, for my first flight, we'd actually gotten up about 3:30 in the morning. And I've got to admit, not my best night's sleep. You know, the anticipation of all that. In my case, again, having waited almost 9 years to get to that first flight, it's like a kid on Christmas morning. You're really, really excited about doing it. Had about 3:30 in the morning when we got up, a largely ceremonial breakfast, and so you have to ask yourself why the coats and ties. Most everybody comes down dressed more like you guys are, just casual clothes. We decided we're going to lend an air of dignity to the breakfast. We have since been superseded. One crew did actually come down in formal attire for their pre-launch. And again, you're not going to eat much. Number one, you probably don't feel like it. Number two, there's that space motion sickness thing. And again, you don't want to have a lot of food in your stomach. You may be visually participating in that exercise. Got suited up, but one of the big changes we made after the Challenger accident, we call our launch and entry suit, up through the Challenger flight, crews launch in this just kind of Nomex flight suit, aviation type flight suit, comfortable but not safe.
we realized after the loss of Challenger crew, we needed to improve crew safety. Full pressure suit. Had the Challenger crew been wearing those full pressure suits, they might have been able to survive. We also wear a personal parachute, and so you could manually bail out of the shuttle. Not the best thing, but after we realized we needed to have some kind of a rescue system, far too complex and expensive to try and go back and put that in, and so they came up with the only thing that would have worked, very, very limited range where you could have used that. Obviously, it's going to be a manual bailout, so you've got to slow the vehicle down to a speed you can survive, somewhere around 220 knots, and we actually did have trained parachutists bail out at those kinds of speeds, and it is survivable in a manual bailout. About almost 100 pounds weight when you put that suit and all that equipment together, so a little bit uncomfortable. Of course, getting into the cockpit, and you'll get a chance. Remember, though, you're very, very fortunate. When you get into the cockpit today, it's horizontal, and you're not wearing a 100-pound suit. But think about that. Launch morning, of course, you're vertical, and so you're getting into an airliner-type seat, but it's like taking the chairs you're in, tilting them 90 degrees backwards, strapped in there very tightly, because when you launch, not only the acceleration, but the vibration. In fact, as a fairly experienced pilot, the acceleration was there, but not a big deal. 8.5 minutes gets to be a big deal, but the 3 G's acceleration, not that big. I pulled 8 or 9 G's in tactical airplanes, dodging missiles over North Vietnam, so a lot more stressful from that standpoint. But it's a long time to be in those suits. Normally, 2.5 hours strapped in on your back there. Not so with my first crew. We had a weather delay. My crew and I spent 6 hours on our backs in the vehicle. And in addition to the fatigue of just being there, I really wish I hadn't had 2 cups of coffee for breakfast. But fortunately, we did launch. This is Discovery on the launch pad. Those sparklers make sure there's no unburned hydrogen in the base of the vehicle. 6 seconds before liftoff, ignite the shuttle main engines, allow the temperatures and pressures to stabilize. Everything looks good. Computer sends a command. All this is onboard software, by the way. Ignites those solid rocket boosters. Tremendous vibration again inside the cockpit, and to me that was more significant than the acceleration. The vibration is really bouncing around. Incredibly enough, they actually give you a pilot's kneeboard so you can take notes. I defy you to write anything legible with that kind of vibration. And again, this point in time, computers are doing the flying, and your job is to monitor the systems, and if you see any anomaly at all, that's where, again, working together as a team, identifying a potential problem, notifying the ground, who probably sees the same thing, and then taking the action recommended by the ground. As we move into future programs, we'll have a little better system than that. Again, the limitation for the shuttle program, the computers. I mean, we just didn't have enough memory to do all the tasks that we wanted, but with modern computer technology, be able to do a lot better than that. Getting on orbit, when those engines shut down, you stop accelerating, and you know, from a knowledge standpoint, you guys all understood what I just said, but think about it. You've accelerated your orbital velocity of 17,500 miles per hour. That's 25 times the speed of sound. You've been accelerating at 3 times the force of gravity. When you reach that target velocity, those engines shut down that quickly. I mean, those valves slam shut, you jettison the external tank, and you go into your coast phase. So when you're circumnavigating the globe every 90 minutes, 45 minutes of daylight, 45 minutes of darkness, you're literally coasting around the planet at 25 times the speed of sound. A very, very busy time. Get out of those heavy launch and entry suits into your on-orbit gear. And you find out, this is where you start to see that there's some of the things that they just can't provide training for. Adapting to that weightless environment and then doing all the normal things. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. But a very, very busy time during the flight. Of course, I'd be remiss if I didn't say the best part of it. Every chance you get, you want to float over the window and take a look outside. I mean, again, you're going around the globe every 90 minutes, 45 minutes of daylight, 45 minutes of darkness, seeing some of the most incredible sights. In this case, the orbiter's underneath the International Space Station. You've got to figure out that's who took the picture. Very, very busy time up there. Again, 45 minutes of daylight, 45 minutes of darkness. So we don't refer to it as daylight or nighttime. It's just your sleep period. Try and get 6 or 7 hours worth of sleep. Most crews like to use the sleep restraints that you can see here. And again, remembering, there's no gravitational vector.
So there is no up or down in terms of a gravitational force. So being sideways, being upside down, blood doesn't rush to your head. It's just perfectly, very, very comfortable to do that. I'm one of a handful of folks, I like to free float to sleep. Some people found that disorienting because you, if you woke up, you'd be like, where am I? And you know, like, well, you know, you're floating, don't worry about it. Just, but you don't have to roll over to go back to sleep. Think about it, no gravity, no pressure points. The arm position, neutral body posture, just where your muscles relax to. So fairly comfortable night's sleep. My flights are both about 5 days each. And so I would spend most of my flight up on the sleep period up on the flight deck. I can get along just fine on an hour or so sleep a night. And I was only for 5 days. And I want to spend all my time looking out the window and taking pictures. And again, absolutely incredible sights. Do have to eat while we're up there. Food has improved a lot since the early days when they squeezed baby food out of tubes. Still can't cook anything, even on the International Space Station. So all the food is pre-prepared, freeze-dried or thermally stabilized food. Space Station, they have recently added some refrigeration. We did not have that, so no fresh fruit or vegetables. About 140 different menu items to choose from. Again, rehydratable, freeze-dried food. Got pretty creative with it in some cases. Here you can see some instant scrambled eggs with some our ever-present hot sauce. I think because of the low humidity environment and the lack of convection, your sense of taste was dulled. Everything tasted bland, and so you didn't want to put a lot of salt on it. So the hot sauce was one way of kind of spicing things up. And again, get pretty creative. Some interesting things from the food standpoint. Of course, fluids are fun. We don't have a bottle of water; it's actually a bag of water, and you put a straw in it and suck it out. But you realize with a fluid in space, physical properties of the water, the adherence of one water molecule, the surface tension of water becomes important. So if I squeeze out a portion of water in that weightless environment, it will form a perfect sphere because of the surface tension of the fluid. And you can take your straw and put it right in there. So I always tell kids, don't try that at home. It doesn't work too well. But a lot of variety in types of food, and particularly if you with the space station, if you have an international crew, we do try and accommodate different taste up there, and that actually makes it a little bit more interesting. The question that nobody ever wants to ask, but everybody wants to know about: so how do you go to the bathroom in space? The good news is, from a human physiology standpoint, our bodies all work the same way. So eating, chewing, swallowing, digesting, and yes, eliminating, your body all does that the same way in space as it does here on Earth. The problem is the facility itself. It's like an airplane laboratory. It operates pretty much like a porta potty, minus gravity. So we have to use airflow to do for you in space what gravity does for you here on Earth. So inside, we call our waste management compartment, both the urine collection device, fecal collection device, and basically we induce airflow into that, and not a vacuum, by the way, but just airflow that either wicks the urine or the solid waste away. It is a bit of a problem. With the on board the shuttle, we actually had an overabundance of water, so we dumped the wastewater in space. Aboard the station, of course, we recycle all the wastewater. So, and you know, you just got to get over it. There are some people really, really get hung up on drinking recycled, and the way I like to characterize it is, you're fine until the day you get your package of recycled water, and the thought hits your mind is, gee, I wonder who contributed. Don't think about it.
That's, yep.
The only other trick to the fecal collection is that in order to make the airflow work, you've got to be firmly seated. And again, you basically never sit up there. I mean, if I could throw a switch and make this room weightless conditions, you wouldn't need your chairs. You'd just float there. Floating there doesn't work, and so you can see at the bottom, we give you foot restraints. You kind of anchor yourself in position, turn the airflow on, do what you came to do, finish the paperwork. This is the payload we carried in my first flight, the big tracking data relay satellite. 200 miles up, by the way, that's about what you're seeing of the Earth in the background. You really don't get to see Earth as a sphere until you're about 5,000 miles. Never did get to see that particular site. Some of the pictures, again, I can spend hours doing this stuff. We don't have time to do that. The Aurora Borealis, like you've never seen it, that's a little over 1,500 miles on the horizon. This was taken with a handheld camera, and the way that you can tell that, you can see a couple of the stars there. See how it's kind of smeared? On our mounted cameras, we actually do motion compensation and didn't have that on the handheld, so you get a little smearing effect. That's why the stars look so big.
this one. A lot of beautiful pictures. This is off the Bahamas, sometimes called the tongue of the ocean. You can see the changing in water color as the depths change here, going from just a few meters to over 3,000 meters deep there, just off the Bahamas. A lot of interest in this, by the way. The Navy, if you're interested in underwater acoustics from space, you can actually see things. The Russian word for it, solons and solutrons. They're internal ocean waves, and when you get those ocean waves colliding, it makes a noise about the same, like a railroad train going down the tracks. If you're interested in hiding a submarine sound signature, good to know where those things are. So lots of research doing there. Same way with geology, meteorology, and the pictures we bring back. We've archived all this, and there's so much in there. Scientists will be working for decades just to go through all the information that's been brought back, even more so now with the International Space Station. Good example here. No, that's not my left lung. That is actually the Mississippi River Delta. But we've been monitoring that and seeing how the effluents have washed down the delta and have been filling in over time. Even more dramatic, on the island of Madagascar, the Betsy Boka River, which was once a navigable waterway over the decades, it's unnavigable now. Ganges River in India, much the same way. So again, monitoring this, hopefully someday we'll be able to do more with the information we have, but a very, very important part of that. My favorite picture from space, a sunset. I kind of gave you a hint about this. Again, 45 minutes of daylight, 45 minutes of darkness. You get to see a sunrise and sunset every single time you orbit the planet. So, every 90 minutes you're seeing a sunrise and sunset. So 16 sunrises and sunsets every day that you have there. Incredibly beautiful. I like to point out that color spectrum in the background. You can see there, as the limb of the Earth is just bisecting the setting sun, that is the sunlight reflecting off the Earth's atmosphere. That thin multicolored line is in fact the 400,000 feet of sensible atmosphere that's out there. And I'll tell you what, all of us who come back, astronauts and cosmonauts alike, marvel at the beauty of this planet we live on, but you realize what a fragile, fragile environment it is. Now we need to do everything we can to protect it. Coming back, we're out over the Indian Ocean. We're going to do our deorbit burn. Again, loading up the computers, letting the computers handle that. Basically, you put all this energy into getting into orbit. Laws of physics don't change. You've got to take that energy back out. We do that as we enter the Earth's atmosphere. Oops. Lost that picture in there someplace. Shooting for a runway landing back here at the Kennedy Space Center. You'll see this. What I was going to do, maybe got switched around there. Anyway, as you're coming back in the Earth's atmosphere, again, a hypersonic vehicle hitting those air molecules, the friction of all that heats up the plasma outside of the vehicle. Surface is on the temperature orbiter between 2800 and 3400 degrees Fahrenheit. You can literally look outside and see your wings going orange from the heat of reentry. This is what you're going to see, the computer display, airspeed on the left, altitude on the right. Your real trick is to keep this dot centered in the circle, line up the overlay with the real runway. You're in the left-hand bank, rolling out. Keep that dot centered. Again, small movements, just handle it. Then you get a bit of an appreciation now. As those two lines converge right there, you get a key down that says flare. That means you're going to have to slow that rate of descent. Remember to put the gear down. No such thing as a wave off. Never had any real problems with landing. Drag chutes, our primary deceleration device there towards the end of the program, saves wear and tear on the gears and brakes. My flights, both 5 days each, not a big problem. Easily, 30 minutes after landing, easily able to walk off. Not so for the people that are up there. The longer you're on orbit, get used to that weightless environment. If you follow the exercise protocol, by the way, on the International Space Station, 2.5 hours a day of hard physical exercise. If you follow it, you're all right. A good friend of mine, Clay Anderson, was up there for 6 months. He worked out like a maniac and then came down and said he still had to go through the rehabilitation protocol, but he was just fine when he came back. But if you don't, you can have some real problems. We plan to replace shuttle, something called Project Constellation, $12 billion into it. That was canceled. A little bit of a change. This is what NASA's building today called the Space Launch System. When I left NASA, I went to work for the Boeing Company and spent a lot of time in research and development. And one of the two things I learned about research and development, if you're running a project like that, it's going to be over budget, behind schedule. I can almost guarantee you that. And so when you see in the newspaper yet again another slip, again, budgetary problems and time constraints are just unbelievable in these kinds of a high technology program. But we're getting some help. You can see we're using some the shuttle main engines as well as the solid rocket boosters, as I mentioned earlier, to help get us there. Instead of the orbiter vehicle, we're going back to a capsule, much like we did during Apollo. Bigger, more complex, so of course a lot more sophisticated technology that's in there to the Orion capsule. But and it frustrates me a little bit when you read these kinds of headlines. The Orion capsule is what's going to take us to Mars. No, it's not. It's not nearly big enough or complex enough to do that. But it's a precursor of the kind of vehicle that we're likely to take when we go to Mars. Again, artist concept of that right now, I believe the schedule is going to slip again because NASA's getting its funding cut. Somewhere in 2017, 2018 for the first unmanned flight, 4 to 5 years after that for the first manned flight of that. Perhaps the most exciting thing going on today, and man, you can't, if you're following aviation or aerospace, you almost can't pick up an article that doesn't refer to commercial space. And from my standpoint, not everybody in the astronaut office agrees with me on this one, by the way. I'm a big proponent of commercial space, of getting private industry in the act. History's on my side. Think back to aviation. Started out as government program, transitioned into the private sector, and that's when we saw the tremendous advances in aviation. I think space program is going to be following that same course, and some exciting, exciting things. Of course, SpaceX has been flying. Orbital ATK has had the resupply missions. Boeing's got their CST-100. Sierra Nevada, the kind of shuttle-looking craft, got a contract to fly cargo up. They'd like to do that with humans as well. So a lot of opportunities in the future, and I think the number of companies involved in this is going to continue to increase. And there's a good reason why. These guys are going to make money. I mean, there's at a minimum a $2 billion a year market out there for flying experiments and all that into space. Yes, sir.
So what's your guess on which private company will have will have crew going up first?
I think Boeing probably will. You know, the fact that I worked for Boeing for 20 years is now, but I do. They've got, I mean, nothing against SpaceX. Great group of people. I mean, really dedicated. And I just don't think, particularly with the problems they've had with losing that one launch, they're still finding their way a little bit. I think they're going to have to iterate a little bit more before they get there. Boeing, you got to remember, Boeing ran, basically it was the shuttle program and space station. So, I put my money on them right now with the CST-1. Yes, ma'am.
I haven't seen the new one.
They
just unveiled it yesterday.
Oh, okay.
So I know that they're in it and they're planning on launching. They already sold all the seats.
Oh yeah, yeah. They've and now that's a little bit different because they're going to do primarily tourism.
Yeah.
You know, this is, and you got, I think the price has gone up a little bit.
$125,000.
Oh, is it just 125?
Yeah.
Well, that's come down then. It was 200, and went up to 250 for a while. And I okay. So, hey, supply and demand. Private enterprise is a wonderful thing. I really is. But anyway, a huge, huge future. I think in all that. Where do we go next? NASA's still wandering a little bit in the desert on this one, but I think everybody will generally, when you brush away all the BS that's associated with it and get down to it. We want to continue the progress to get to Mars. Anybody see the movie Martian, by the way?
Oh, yeah.
It was actually interesting. I saw the movie, and the day after I saw the movie, it was fortunate we had one of the JPL rover drivers that gave us a lecture about the conditions. And he validates, you know, some of the science is a little, the whole growing potatoes and poop. Well, I don't know about that one. But in terms of the conditions on Mars and the terrain and the problem, very, very realistic from that standpoint. So time frames, and I still don't believe the fact that you could use duct tape to repair a hole in your eyes. But that's another story. So you got to give those folks a little bit of leeway. Yes, ma'am?
Back to your landing or your gliding in. How do you determine what you land?
That's picked a pre-flight, and early on we went to Edwards because as a backup you had the desert runway out there. You had 5 miles of runway, which gave you a bigger margin of error. Shuttle runway, still the longest in the world, 15,000 feet. There's one here, there's one at Edwards. There's actually one at Vandenberg Air Force Base there, not too far away from it. In other words, that was going to be part of the military shuttle program. It's just a big concrete runway sitting out there right now. Originally targeted Edwards because of the bigger margin of error. We preferred to come back here. So someplace along the line, the priority shifted to Kennedy because of the cost of having to fly the shuttle back on the 747. So Kennedy became the landing site of choice, primarily for the driven by the cost. If the weather is bad here, Edwards was their backup. Anybody remember the one flight that landed at either Kennedy or Edwards? White Sands, New Mexico, STS-3, third flight of the shuttle. Both the places were weathered in, and ended up going to. I know because I was on the ground at White Sands during that landing. Oh, I'm still getting the caliche dust out of my hair. Yes.
I've read that there is a backup landing through by the Easter Island.
Oh, there are actually multiple backup landing sites worldwide for emergency type landings and for planned emergencies. So one of our abort modes in the shuttle, if we can't get to orbit and we've gone too far to get back and land back at the Kennedy Space Center, landing in Spain, but there's a site in Germany, and again, there's a site in Canada, multiple sites around Easter Island. Easter Island would be an interesting challenge because I'm not sure you could ever get the orbiter back off the runway there. When you put that orbiter on top of the 747, you need a lot of runway to get it. So you might have to abandon the shuttle there. We're not worried about that anymore. But a good question. Anything else? All right. Well, I know you guys are excited about getting started. We're going to have an opportunity. We will do, if you care to, a picture. We'll kind of do a postcard type scenario out there, pose and take a picture and with your own cameras, and then we'll get started on the fun part of the day for you guys, the training. So thank you all very much. Let's please go ahead and thank you.